is Primus Tracks with Josh, Ricky, and Sawyer.
What a couple of dumb shits. Hello, primates! You found Primus Tracks, congratulations! But hey, you know, you found the podcast. You can also find us at Primus Tracks on Instagram and Twitter. PrimusTracksPod@gmail.com is the email address. A lot of great ways to get in contact with me. I'm Josh. You can also use those or go to the Facebook page to talk to the man way up there in the 38th floor of Primus Tracks Towers in Mexico City, Frankie Bearstein.
Good evening, children.
I can see his forehead. I can see the reflection in his glasses of all the Bowie pictures on his monitor. Frankie's ready. But we have help today, Frankie. We're talking about the title track to Les Claypool and the Holy Mackerel present Highball with the Devil. I guess we have two title tracks because there's Holy Mackerel and Highball with the Devil. So we're going to talk about the first title track, Holy Mackerel. And it's great that these two gentlemen are here. First of all, he was in the room. He knows all the settings, and he's going to tell us you know, how much at each frequency band we need to turn our boards to so we can approximate what Les did. It's Tim Soya.
What's happening?
Hey, Tim.
So you're checking in from where this time?
I am currently in Zurich, Switzerland. Schweiz, they like to say. Rolling along, crisscrossing Europe. A lot of driving around, but it's good. They got internet in Switzerland, too, so here I am.
Good of the Swiss to do that for us. Thank you for being here again, Soya, at 5 in the morning in your dark hotel room.
And that's good.
We're also going to bring in a bass maestro who's going to help us with this track. You know his name, and you can find him at HamOfTruth86. Welcome back, Matt Hunter.
Hey, how's it going?
It's going great. Oh, man. I think we felt quite a bit of a jolt of excitement to get into this record. And judging, Frankie, I don't know if you've looked at the first post for this album on Instagram. There's a lot of buzz.
Yes, people went nuts.
As they often do when they see Holy Mackerel, you know, flying around and hitting them in the face like Asian carp or something. So we are here all gathered to talk about the Holy Mackerel. It's taking me back to my Catholic youth.
This is my favorite track on the album, Josh.
Oh, wow. Let's get that out of the way. It's Frankie's favorite track on the album.
Episode's over. All right. See you guys.
Let's pack it in. Good one. Thanks for getting up, Soya. You all have a great day. Wow, just the second track, and Frankie's already making these proclamations. All right. Well, you better bring the energy today, Frankie, because I'm going to turn it over to you for the track history.
All right. How about, Josh, we kick things off with a quote. This is taken from Bass Player magazine. Les said the following. Jane Lane plays drums on this track. He's my hero. I play a lot of drums on the record, and he's the guy I always emulate. Joe Gore plays the rhythm guitar parts. He came over with this wacky pedal, chose the king of old knick-knacky guitar toys, and when he whipped out his box, he started in with that binka-banka-bink stuff. At first, I wasn't too attracted to it. I loved the sound, but I thought it sounded kind of like a keyboard. I would hate for people to think it's a synthesizer or something, you know? But then he played that little arpeggiated lick over there on the side, and it really grew on me. We just left a big hole for MIRV to come in and blast something into it, and he did a fine job. I'm playing my Carl Thompson fret 6. I play it a lot when I'm with Jay. That's the story with many of the tunes. They start with a group for me and Jay, and then somebody comes in and fills in things on top. This was the first track we laid down.
All right, so Soya, you might not have been in the room yet if this was the first one they laid down, or do you remember?
I was not there the moments that him and Jay laid down the initial tracks, the ones that Jay did.
Okay.
Les will do that sometimes where he'll say, okay, come on up, and he'll have like – he had like 3 or 4 songs he did with Jay, and he was filling in the gaps, like you said. So I was kind of spotty in and out on this one, you know, because Les was really trying to do it all on his own, like hit my own record that I did all by myself, and – he needed some help. So, you know, I was there for half of it. I don't know. I did all the mix down stuff for sure in the tour, but it was a private endeavor of his for sure. But I was not there for the J-Ski tracking moments where that would be just him and Jay. Like Jay came up and they'd track shit with just those two in the room, you know?
Which must have been pretty exciting for them.
I wish I was goddamn there, but I was not.
This isn't too far removed from that sausage record, too. We're only talking about a couple of years.
So he went on to elaborate about the bass tone. The tone on each song began with the bass itself. I recorded direct. It's just cleaner and easier, and you have much more control. And I run through an ADA MB1 preamp. So usually I just grab a bass and plunk around as I hit a bunch of different settings until I find the one I like. But it has to sound good with that particular bass. The actual bass is more important than the setting.
Matt, what do you say to that?
And the bass he has chosen is the bass of all basses, if you ask me.
You bet, that fretted six. What do you think about that, Matt?
Yeah, I was just reading this today, actually. I've often met the raw end of a Soya speculating on what gear and settings and things were used on various things. So anybody's guess is as good as mine. I do think that I don't know at what point, but it sounds like a lot of Les's recorded tones for many years have probably been primarily direct. That's pretty common practice in a lot of, you know, studio settings for bass players is there's a lot of control over the sound, especially with that amount of low end content that you're trying to push through an amplifier and speakers and capture with a microphone. Usually retain a lot more of that fidelity, and it holds together a lot when you're direct. And then you can also, you can play with it pre, post, you can reamp it, you can do all sorts of fun stuff with it. So but yeah, the six string fretted, this era of the discography, you know, somewhere in the range of Pork Soda to Holy Mackerel / Brown is when like all the big players are in the picture. So you got the Rainbow floating around in there, you got the fretted six floating around a lot. And you know, the four string still shows up, and
the all echo the other, is there as well.
Yeah, all the other fun stuff on this record, like the echo. So yeah, the six string fretted probably between Punchbowl, this, and Brown is kind of like the heyday of the fretted six. That's when it's showing up all over the place. Even on songs, I guess all the way up to Antipop, really showing up on songs that are really written for four string, but he liked the sound of the recorded bass so much that he just used it a lot in recording, at least so the interviews say, and that's what it sounds like to my ears as well. And it's a beastly sounding thing. I love it.
Always is, yeah. No matter what, the recording setup seems to be slick for Antipop, this DIY aesthetic for Holy Mackerel. You can hear that fretted six. So, you know, he does say, to go back to that quote, the actual bass is more important than the setting, and you can really hear it with your ears if you're listening for that specific bass.
Mm-hmm. How about some live history, Josh? Holy Mackerel was premiered on August 24th, 1996 at Slim's in San Francisco. It was in heavy rotation during the Holy Mackerel tour of 96. It was then handed over to Frog Brigade, which performed it also quite heavily. And then it was handed over to the Fancy Band, who made a very special arrangement for the track. But prior to the song becoming a Fancy Band staple, it was performed on and off by various projects. I mean, whenever Les took a break from Primus or other things, and he was doing a lone show here and there. For example, Holy Mackerel in 2005 at Bimbo's, they did the track. Frog Brigade Jam Cruise 2005, they did the track. Bucket of Burning Brains even did the track only once. So it was not present exclusively on tours, but also during special performances, no, like one-offs. After the Fancy Band, it was performed at a wine party in 2016. The last performance to date was part of the 2019 Holy Mackerel performance at the Hop Monk Tavern as part of a wine party again, of course.
So according to Toasterland, we have 75 live performances. This is right in line with Gauntlet with 79. So this one has lasted the test of time.
I am extremely eager to see the track return to the set lists with the impending Frog Brigade tour.
Hey, maybe that new fretless six stringer that Dan Maloney made him will inspire him to play it.
I bet they'll play it. I don't see why not. Les loves that song, so it's kind of a signature song.
Yeah,
that's why it's
exactly
been a rotation through all the bands. You know,
sure hope we see it. Yeah, it's lasted this long. Bring it on back.
So anyone who listens to the show knows that Josh and I love music, but we are not musicians ourselves, so Matt, Can you please shed some light on what is going on in this track musically? It just sounds pretty complex to my ears, but perhaps you could break it down for us.
Like the last track that I was on, if I can remember what it was.
DMV 2 years ago.
Yeah. Temporary Phase.
Oh, sure.
I tried to figure out some of what the guitar is doing too, so that I can bring that in. Because really, the guitar is kind of doing a lot more between, you know, the two players on the track are doing a lot more than the bass necessarily. So the bass is just kind of holding down, grooving in the background most of the time. But I'll try to, you know, shed some light on the guitar stuff as well here. So, but I have the bass on. So we're on the sixth string. Like I said, I have my fretless here. It was performed on the fretted on the record. And then, you know, through the years, depending on what bass comes out on tour, it'll just get played more often than not. It was more the rainbow in the last couple decades. So it's been played on the rainbow a lot more live. But we start off in F sharp. We kind of ride up to an F sharp from an A to a B to an F sharp. And
yeah.
All right. And then we're kind of hanging out in this C sharp kind of range, which is where a lot of the six string fretless tunes kind of hang out in. Like Mud's kind of down here for the most part. Tweak on the tweak again. And so we're going from C sharp to D to E. And we're just kind of riding that up. And then there's an octave thrown for the C sharp in there. So, and it's all, it's just kind of hammer and slap. There's some cool live footage of Les. He really kind of hams up the slap, you know?
Yeah.
And every once in a while, he'll catch, you know, the octaves that we talk about up on the two highest strings here. He does the fifths to kind of just fill some space in there, which is another pretty common thing. That kind of thing.
Yeah.
And that's kind of where Les is kind of hanging out for most of the song. And every once in a while, it comes back to the...
Mackerel.
Yeah. And that's other than Les kind of going up an octave and doing a little bit kind of a more solo-y thing later on in the tune. That's pretty much where the bass sits, I think, through the whole song, even under the solo and everything. Mm-hmm. So the guitar is doing a lot of really interesting stuff, though, too, on top of that. So let me switch to that real quick.
Yeah. While you're switching, I should mention our track credits are Les, of course, on bass and vocals, Jay Lane on drums, Joe Gore on guitar, all the rhythm stuff that we hear, and then MIRV blasts through with a guitar solo about halfway through the track. So we've got quite a lineup here.
Yeah. So what it sounds like to me, and I don't know this for sure, you can really go down the rabbit hole with guitar pedals and try to find exactly, but to me what it sounds like some kind of an old fuzz, like a really trashy kind of fuzz that has a lot of gating to it. Because when he's doing a lot of this comping and a lot of this funky stuff, it's kind of cutting in and out in an almost synthy kind of way. And that's something that a lot of old fuzz pedals are described as sounding like synthy, because it cuts in and out really kind of jagged. That's pure speculation. I don't know if that's actually what he's using, but that's what I tried to do to approximate that here is I actually did. I have like a digital modeling, you know, thing here, a line six thing. And so I just put in a really hard gate to where it just kind of lets the signal through just a little bit. It's not exact, but it's kind of in the ballpark there. Might even do better without the distortion. And so we're kind of just comping in this range of the C sharp, like where Les is hanging out in. We're going down to a B. When Les goes up, we're just kind of comping down to the B. And then every once in a while to the fifth, like a power chord, like just kind of a quick stab.
Yeah.
Like that. And the other really cool thing that's going on is there's some cool arpeggios with some, it sounds like either vibrato or tremolo. I can't really, it's hard to tell in the recording exactly what it is, but some kind of an effect where the notes kind of pulse in and out, and we're going for it from a, look, I'm fancy, I took notes. We're going from a C sharp minor 7 to a C sharp minor 6.
Nice. That sounds pretty close, man. That's that's got that wash to it.
That's sort of the first thing that comes in other than the clomping kind of funky guitar goes into that. And then, you know, something along the lines of just a... Just for the chorus, just to kind of mirror what Les is doing.
And there's a little more drive on that, if I recall.
Got to get the fractal going. We're grabbing
that's right, yeah. Yeah, I don't have a fancy floor unit for all this stuff yet.
Yeah.
Just good old, you know, fifths like that. And then MIRV comes in and rips it up. And this is Lur is so far out there in Lur land that I'm usually have a very hard time deciphering what he's doing, because I do mainly come from a pretty, like, you know, heavy metal or blues or like rock and roll kind of background.
Yeah.
I don't get real fancy with theory. I don't listen to a lot of, you know, jam bands or Dead or things like that. So what Lur does is just like half the time it's alien to me, and I figure out little bits that I really, really like. But then MIRV comes in here. He's ripping pentatonic. I'm right at home. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So MIRV, he's doing some of these bluesy bends, you know, where you take two notes and you're rubbing them up against each other, real classic blues stuff, but he's coming up in a kind of almost kind of diminished intervals here, riding up into the scale. He does that twice and kind of builds it up here.
Yeah.
And then he just hangs out, you know, right in the C sharp, you know, kind of pentatonic land. And every once in a while he's thrown in some notes that are, you know, a little more dissonant, to kind of just like a half step off. That's where that solo kind of lands at the end. That last note is especially like when it lands on that, because you're just one half step down, and then it kind of resolves right up to it.
Yeah, that's a little off-putting, isn't it? That's cool.
Yeah, and that's obviously not exactly how MIRV's playing it. I wasn't gonna, like, you know, dissect it note for note necessarily, but he's hanging out in that kind of blues box land. So
yeah,
And
we know he can rip it like that. I think the only thing missing, and Soya, help me out here, I don't think Matt was making the faces right.
Yeah.
You got to shave your head, brother, if you're going to do some MIRV action.
That's right. No, I can't nail the faces. No way.
You like to do the scat thing, too. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Just a note on that. There was a wine event, you know, at Les's wine place, winery, I guess, and MIRV's band Uncle Sea Monster just played, you know, a night or two ago, and all the pictures, MIRV is just hamming it up and making these faces while he's playing. And, you know, so you've talked about it, and I just went, yeah, it's automatic.
Yeah, and he does he scats along with what he's playing is another funny one with his face making.
Ah, hilarious.
Did Les sit in on that, or was it just Uncle Sea Monster played?
Just Uncle Sea Monster, from what I have gathered.
Okay. I obviously was not able to attend, or I would have been there for sure.
Oh, man. It was an all-star lineup. You would have had to be there. Flounce and Fred was there.
Yeah.
old Flounce.
Les texted me a picture of Flounce and Fred when he was there. That's funny.
Matt, I have to thank you for modeling Joe's parts, especially because I want to appreciate Joe Gore's parts, especially on this tune. And there's a couple of reasons why. One is what he does is very melodic. I mean, he's doing the plinky, that plinky part isn't very melodic, but that arpeggiated lick very much is. And then he does a really cool pull-off part after the first go-round of that slowdown to that holy mackerel. But then he just leaves all that space for MIRV to come in and go crazy. So I really always liked Joe's playing on this, on the couple of tracks that he is on with this record. I want to point to something that Les had said in some interview coming up in 1994, so this interview is 30 years old. He said, I'm going to do this project called Brainless Gore. And I know I've mentioned it on the pod before. It's been a couple years. Brain and Les and Joe Gore were going to do a power trio project of a sort. Nothing ever came of it. I asked Joe and he said, yeah, it was. We had the plans, but everything fell through and it never happened. But this is, I suppose, just a smidgen of what it might have sounded like to get those three guys together and do something. And it's Frankie's favorite. To me, it's the most fully formed tune on the record. I really feel like they, you know, and it kind of makes sense. It was the first one and they really went for it with the arrangements and all the different parts.
Speaking of which, yeah, you mentioned that was the one part I've neglected to mention. It is another kind of plucky, kind of gaity thing. And he's doing the fifths and then he's doing our old favorite tritone on there. So it's like,
yeah.
Just kind of,
it's cool
going from the fifth to the third, you know, playing with half steps and diminished and tritones and all the bag of tricks. So, but yeah, I agree. This is, you know, I thought of when Les was talking about playing with Jay, often using the fretted six, there was the, is it called Two Guys Named Schmo?
Three Guys Named Schmo. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's that going on. And then you throw Joe into the mix and then you got MIRV doing a solo. It feels like, it's not a premonition, but it's sort of a preview of what would come sort of later in like a Frog Brigade kind of format where you've got like sort of a all-star lineup of people just kind of throwing their flavors on top of it. And yeah, it's a very fully formed track. I think it works, you know, obviously works really well in a live setting. A lot of these tracks have translated really well across different lineups and with different kind of other musicians putting their own flavors on it. So yeah, it's a really well-rounded tune. And it's just kind of a stomper, and it's really catchy.
Yeah, and with that bass line you're showing, you know, there's no real theatrics until we get to the solo near the end of the track. But there's, you know, there's a great groove there. And that's a lot of fun to hear. It's always great when Les just lays something down without being showy. And I know he doesn't try to show off. He's just being himself. But when he does something fairly, and I'm using air quotes, simple, can groove like a son of a gun, and it's always really cool to see because you don't have to go a million miles an hour all the time. It's kind of great that way. I do want to play a few parts because I think you're going to get a few things you like here. I love the wee, that really high falsetto wee that he does. I'm not even going to try to hit it after yelling at sixth graders all day, but we'll start with that one. Way up there. Under a really cool J Lane groove, too. That contrast with the wee way up there, and then he comes back down with only mackerel. So he's.
Jay is actually hitting the rack tom on the floor tom, which is cool. Which is great, you know? The same drum kit that's on the Sausage record. It's Les's kit.
The steel kit, right?
That's the kit that Jay was playing live in Primus when I first came around Primus.
That's amazing.
Same kit.
He's going to have to be buried with that thing.
Man.
He's synonymous with it.
it's a huge kit, man. I can't play it. It's too big. It's like 24-inch kick, and the rack tom is 14, and the floors are 18, 20.
By contrast, in your Victim's Family kit, what are you rocking on that one?
Oh, my kit is 2013-16.
So okay.
It's like standard basic sizes.
But considerably smaller.
I'm a short dude, and to have a 24-inch kick, I can't play a 24. I have trouble with a 22. And he's got the 24, and then there's the 14-inch by 12-inch deep rack tom on top of it. So it's like 8 feet in the air. Try to get your stick up there and hit it, you know?
Pass.
As far as size, the drum kit sounds way different compared to like Green Naugahyde, for example, where the kit sounds a lot more compact and kind of smaller and like peppers.
Green Naugahyde might not have been that kit because he also at one point he bought Curveball's old Gretsch kit, and that's up there as well. If I'm not mistaken, Green Naugahyde was Jay, and he might have done it on the Gretsch kit on that one. I wasn't there for that one either.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So I'd have to ask Les, but you can tell that stainless kit, like you can hear it. I can hear it in this track because it's not the metal over wood stainless kit. It's like the shells are just stainless steel, you know, and they ring. The tone is very like boomy and ringy, and I could tell when that kit's being played, you know.
Uh-huh.
Especially when he hits the toms because they're just like wide open, you know.
For sure.
That's not a real common feature for a lot of kits, right? To be made, I mean, snares, obviously, a lot of them are made out of different metal alloys and things like that. But like the only other drummer that I'm aware of that regularly used a full metal kit was like Danny Carey, for example. I think he's got like a big, like a bronze or a brass type.
Yeah, the pasty kit. Yeah.
Yeah.
He only uses the kick drums of that kit now, which he still uses like live right now.
Mm.
He doesn't use any of the toms that last time I was sitting at his kit, he didn't have any of the toms, but he did have the kicks. Anyway, yeah, full on metal kits are, that's a rare bird, man, that even existed in the 80s, 70s. I don't know when they made that kit or what the year that kit is, but you know, there's some companies that do it now. A&F is an all metal company. They do it, but that kit is very unique and a rare bird, man. And that's why Les loves it, you know, because he knows that it's like very unique.
It certainly has that singular sound. And
the big sizes make it even more crazy, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You get over onto that 20-inch floor tom after you've gotten to the 18-inch floor tom. It's like behind you. You're trying to get, you know, yeah. You can't even get to the damn thing.
Turning that far. Yeah. He achieves quite a sound throughout the record, whether he's playing it or Jay is. We're going to talk about that drum sound throughout, I think, because it is so different. I just want to play my favorite part, and it's that Joe Gore pull-off part right after that Holy Mackerel. And Frankie, I'm sure you have a few time codes as well. Yeah. I think what I really like about that part is how, not timidly, but just how understatedly those arpeggios come in halfway through. It's pretty cool that way, that's what they went with. Love that Joe Gore part. I think it's really cool. And then at about 2 minutes, there's a pretty sick bass fill. Matt, I won't challenge you to play it, but
I might.
It's pretty short, but it always stood out to me as a teenager when I picked up this record. And I can tell you guys, I didn't tell you this, Frankie. I always tell you where I pick up these records. This came out on August 27th, 1996, as we've said before. They had a big old poster, 18x24 promo poster, in the window at Co-op Tapes and Records in Davenport, Iowa, which was about a 7-minute walk from my house. And I would go there all the time looking for tapes, CDs in the used bin, and then when something new was coming out, that's where I went to pick things up. They had that poster in the window, and so I was just amped for this release. Went there the day it came out, bought the CD, came home, listened to it, loved it. But I can tell you that 18x24 poster, it was double-sided, so the side facing out into the street was sun-faded really fast, and then the one on the inside was in perfect shape. About 3 weeks after the record had been out, I went back and I said, "What's up with that poster?" And the guy said, "Give me a quarter." Gave the guy a quarter. He gave me the promo poster, and it was up in my bedroom for, you know, 73 years.
You still got it?
I gave it away. It was just in such shit shape because I moved it a dozen times into different apartments and houses and whatnot. It was falling apart, and I just gave it away. Somewhat regretfully at this point, because it was hard to find now. It was a cool promo poster. It was just the cover artwork.
Mm-hmm.
But this little fill here always stood out to me because it was so sharp because of kind of how understated Les plays throughout the track. And then we get this sick-ass fill here. Yeah. I love that sound right there, too. Mm-hmm. I mean, he is popping it hard.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus God, that fretted six.
With Jay doing cymbal catches and a kooky little fill right in the middle of it all, and all fits together, you know?
Yeah, I'm going to play that again so we can appreciate those drums, too, because it becomes chaotic in that 4 seconds. Pretty sure I heard some toms, too.
Total Jay Lane, man.
Can you play two minutes with 19 seconds? That's one of my favorite parts.
Hey, that's right before the guitar solo.
It's very dramatic.
Into the solo.
The second one is even more dramatic than the first one. The Holy Mackerel part.
Yeah, it is. It is. It's very big. And then MIRV just comes in and blows the top off of the thing. What I really love about those bends, Matt, is he gives it a rah-rah-rah on one, mm-hmm. one of those iterations through that. It's always these little things that stuck with me, I think, as a young guy. And I remember 27 years ago when this came out, that little rah-rah-rah on that bend, mm-hmm. and it's just been with me ever since. So there's always these strange little things on these records that have stuck with me.
You forward to 3 minutes with 30 seconds?
3:30?
There's some really nice writes.
I just called it a throaty groan. I didn't know what to call it when he's way down here doing the... Yes.
and we get some right.
If all four of us want to do that together, we can pretend we've been smoking nothing but unfiltered cigarettes for 40 years. And just give it the old,
Oh, what am I doing?
That ting, Jay, ting,
instrumentation
ting.
On this song is out of this world.
I like it a lot.
Jay just grooves so hard on this song. It just sounds fantastic.
Everybody's on top of their game.
It does Working sound great.
That ride cymbal bell is awesome.
Yeah, when he hits that bell and it really just cuts through that ding, ding, ding. And he's, you know, it's leading to something there.
Yeah.
I'm going to turn it way up here at the very end, and I'm going to try not to blow your drums out here. I almost said ear balls. At the very end, very faintly, you can hear Les and Jay talking, and they say... Oh, there it was. It was very faint and very fast. You hear Les say, "We can do it better." So they must have run through a take, and then, let's do it again.
Probably.
Yeah. And it's so funny that he left that on the record. You have to listen really carefully for it, and it's really, really faint and really fast, but it's in there.
I don't remember that. It's funny because I helped Les mix this, so I had to have heard everything.
You know, unless he snuck it in there later, you would have probably heard that track or take or something, right?
No, there was no sneak ins. Just I can't remember. You know, love that though. There's a lot of that across a lot of the records that we did up there. You know, little sneaky things left in at the end.
Well, and let's think about the Riddles Are Abound Tonight track. It's got a false start in it, for crying out loud, you know?
They talk in the end on that one, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
he goes, "Fuck!" He's like, "That wasn't that bad, man."
That's right, yeah. So they do, I do like that they keep that stuff in there. It does make it feel more natural, as opposed to some kind of product, you know?
Right on.
Some highly processed thing. This one has a lot of nice highlights musically.
Yes.
What do you think about lyrics, Frankie?
Okay. I've been waiting a long time for this track to come along because over the years, I've gone over the lyrics multiple times. And the best I can come up with is that it seems to be some kind of very general autobiographical overview. But there are several phrases which I really don't get. And I'm not sure if the overall message of the track is that it's meant to be autobiographical per se, or if it's more like a general commentary about life. But I must say that the lyrics are pretty confusing for me most of the time with this track. I'm not completely sure what it's about. What's your take, Josh?
Yeah, there's not a lot to them. as far as I'm concerned. I just wrote down it's seemingly stream of consciousness. Nothing thematically really holds them together. But it, you're right, there are some autobiographical parts, there's some fashion advice, and then we hear about old Sporty. And that's about it. Like, there's, you know, the term holy mackerel is a cultural idiom that is a term of surprise, but it's also a nice pun if you're into fish, of course, or fishing. So other than that, you know, some holy mackerel, you know, it's funny because he doesn't deliver the phrase holy mackerel in a way that indicates surprise. We just get a holy mackerel, you know, with a funny pronunciation. So, I don't know. I don't take this to be a series of, surprises or anything. It's just some lyrics. And this is one of the first times I've ever seen that.
Pick a place. Chances are it had the means to be there. Sounds like Liz traveling all over the world because of fame, right?
Sure.
I've got it from a friend of mine, the ability to socialize. Who is that friend in question?
I have a feeling Les was always pretty capable of being a socialite on his own. I don't know that he had to learn from somebody else.
Mm-hmm. What does it mean to cultivate a pompadour?
You know what a pompadour is? It's a, you ever heard of a pompadour? It's a goofball haircut. It's a hairstyle in which the front sits up pretty high, right?
Elvis Presley had a pompadour.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
In the heyday, that big poofy hairdo, that's a pompadour.
Yeah. And so
Johnny Bravo.
There's
emulating Elvis pretty much.
That's the cultural reference that people will understand. Half of them are going, who's Elvis?
Super real, dude.
It's not a joke.
So when he says when you cultivate a pompadour, it's best to keep the top up for the breeze, cuts like hell, you know? Mm-hmm. What does it mean?
My interpretation of this is what he's saying is to keep your pompadour nice and poofy, put the top up on the convertible so the wind doesn't screw it up.
Is it a metaphor for something?
You got me.
It sounds like Les bambling on about nothing.
Yeah, it's just Les telling you not to ride around in a convertible if you've got a nice coiffed hair like that. You don't want
like
to
Matt.
It could have been, you know, about a friend of his that wore his hair like that, like Matt has his right now.
Yeah.
Don't I mean, Les pulls references like out of his bag of references that no one will ever know what he's talking about.
Yeah. These are pretty obtuse as far as that goes, you know.
However, the last part about Johnny Law took a decade of his life. It is quite straightforward, and I think it's going to be a recurrent topic in the lyrics throughout the record. But we'll get into those particular ones when we reach those tracks. But I think the drug thing is permeating a lot of the tracks on the album, starting with this one.
Well, shoot, they permeate a lot of Primus records up to this point, too. So.
Exactly.
A lot of pot smoking on this one, I remember. Les was smoking a lot of weed at that moment.
Well, yeah, and so was Sporty, I guess. Puffed his pipe into the night and then sold a cop some ecstasy. Oops.
I wonder who that is. I'd have to ask Les.
Yeah, I would love to know who Sporty is and if he's still around. That little dime he did has been over for quite some time.
Yeah, he probably won't tell me because that's one of his well-kept secrets sometimes with the characters in his songs.
Sure. And he wants to keep their anonymity but still tell stories about him, yeah.
Right on. Yeah. Change the names to protect the innocent.
You bet. Mm. Or in this case, the guilty, I guess.
They're not so innocent, but protect the names.
To me, Frankie, there's not too much to trouble over here. So if these lyrics vex you, I suggest that you just let them fly, because
it's probably one of those cases where only Liz knows exactly what the song is about, right?
Right on.
For sure.
That's what I was just trying to say.
So we'll never know what it's about. We just gotta enjoy it.
I can't remember. Were the lyrics included in the booklet with this album?
Yes.
Yes.
They were? He actually wrote the lyrics. Oh, okay, cool.
Well, Frankie's gonna go to a bunch of VIP Frog Brigade shows, so he's going to ask, at each show, he's gonna ask a particular question about each couplet. And say what was wrong
until,
with your knees
until we have the full story.
Yeah, so in like in Boston it'll be what was wrong with your knees, and then the next show in New York it'll be tell me about that pompadour, you know, and then down in Philadelphia you can say come on Sporty,
tell me about that friend of yours.
I'm an old buddy of yours from the back door.
How's going on with this guy? So yeah, not much to the lyrics as far as we can take away from them. At any rate, they are fairly Byzantine. I do want to get to our primates' takes. If you are interested in having your takes about the track up for discussion, all you have to do is go to patreon.com/PrimusTracks. One of the most wonderful features of being a patron is I will read your takes right here. Now, we're kind of recording on a quick turnaround, so I only have a couple primates' takes for the title track, Holy Mackerel. I'm sorry, the first of two title tracks, Holy Mackerel. I want to point out Johnny Perona, who said the opening track, Running the Gauntlet, was a bit jarring insofar as it definitely did not hit, sound, or feel like Primus. And of course, Johnny's talking about when he first heard this record. Holy Mackerel wrapped me in the warm, thunderous tones of the fretted six and assured me that everything was going to be okay. That is a really nice way to phrase it. John Shreve says, every time I hear this song, it brings me to simpler times when Fancy Band was playing House of Blues shows and Skerrick and Mike Dillon were standard issue. It's equal parts silly
those,
and funky.
Those were the times.
Those were the days. and Anthony Del Preet says, true that the fretted six is killer, but one of my best concert memories is when they busted this out at Tipitina's in May 2002 as the opening track on the Rainbow. And he says this is an awesome tune with a fat-ass bass line. One might even call it thick, Frankie.
Thank you. Thanks for that.
So those are your primates' takes. Thank you guys, as always, for your contributions. And now, it's everybody's favorite. Frankie's
live cuts.
It's time to walk us through some live cuts. Our first live cut from Frankie Beristein to my inbox, which I have to find now. Sorry. This is from La Luna, 1996.
Portland.
Oh, Portland, Oregon. Very good.
Yeah, and the venue is La Luna.
Long before I moved to this state, so I didn't have a chance in hell of being at this show.
I was there.
Soya was there, and that's what counts. Well, we're going to hear an Adam Gates intro.
I'm excited to hear this.
Me too.
Good evening, children. Today we gather in this holy place to honor our shepherd, a good man, a holy man, with most capable hands, Mr. Les Claypool. Before we start this evening's prayers, if you would be so good to follow me in a hymn to the Great One.
Crowd's on it.
To rub you on my buttocks. To rub you on my buttocks is my biggest wishy, wishy. Is my biggest wishy, wishy. You are blessed, children.
And off they run. And that is Brain on drums, and they are picking up the pace there for sure. Wow.
Absolutely brilliant.
That only Adam Gates could conceive.
And it sets the tone so well. I mean,
I think he did
it
that
makes
intro
the intro so compelling.
Yeah.
That was the intro every night until they started doing the Bad Boys Cops thing.
Oh, okay. So they started with this and then shifted to Bad Boys.
I think so, yeah, if I remember right.
Of course, we're going to talk about the tour in great detail once we finish this record because there's just so much happening there. But that's a nice taste of what you would have gotten in 1996 on the Mackerel tour. And Soya is all smiles.
That was a good run, man. A lot of fun. Good band.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of a good band, let's forward to the guitar solo here and let MIRV do the talking.
Thank you.
Holy crap. I like that solo, but I'm just listening to Brain go mad with the drums there. Wow. He's driving.
Brain was killing it.
Wow. I think he's using Lur's Vistalite drum kit on that tour, too, which is funny.
God. Whatever he's using, he's pounding the bejesus out of it.
He's got a Lur has an orange Vistalite kit, which...
Really?
A kick drum made it way into the Primus future because it was the boom kick drum that was way off to the side for a while that Jay played.
Oh, and the big one.
Yeah, it would have been like Naugahyde era because when I came back and messed around with some stuff during the Naugahyde touring, that orange kick drum was out there again.
Okay.
Like, let's just kind of like put it into the Primus world because they never really used it.
Oh, interesting. So that was the big boom one when Jay would
and
turn.
And we used some of Lur's kit on that Jellybean kit for the Brown album tour in the beginning when we had the Vistalite kit as well.
Oh, very good.
And I'm pretty sure the snare drum you were just hearing was one of mine that Brain used for that tour.
Oh, sick. It's immortalized. That's awesome. Is that one that's on the rack of snares at your house that I always see?
It would definitely be one of those, yeah.
Nice.
Probably the chartreuse sparkle one he always loved to play. So I think it was that. That drum went on the tour.
Oh, killer. That's cool. I didn't know that Soya and Lur had drums laying around for these guys. This is so cool. Fun fact.
Well, Lur is always buying gear, you know, and then he just ends up not using it. So...
Frankie, take note. It's the Lur kick drum.
What kind of a snare is that, Soya?
That would be a Joe Montaneri custom 5x14 maple, 10-ply maple.
Sounds killer. That Brain's sound in his playing in that clip was like he was killing it.
It's very signature Brain for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Ugh, yeah. So forward. So
it's aggressive. It's pre DW. I'm not going to diss on DW too much, but. The sound of the DWs I'm not so into, but that sound right there, even though those Vistalites are terrible, that it just sounds killer, you know?
Yeah.
The Vistalites kind of emulate that same wide open sound as that stainless steel kit, if you ask me.
Mm.
And those particular ones, those orange ones of Lur's are 70s, so the edge is really shitty and square and boxy, so...
Mm.
Can't really make them sound good. They are what they are, you know?
You just have to deal with it.
Yeah, so you can tell when he goes to the toms on the floor on that particular cut, you can tell they're just like, what the fucking shitty drums are those? They don't sound killer, like perfect killer wooden drums. You know?
Our next live cut is from October 4th, 1996. No location, but October 4th. Let's hear the
October 4th, 1996 belongs to the Electric Ballroom in Arizona.
Soya was there too.
Yes, I was.
Let's hear it.
So bouncy.
Sounds like a board tape to me.
Frankie's favorite.
The stuff of heaven.
All right. So those are our couple. And you know, this was 96. So audience recordings are probably hard to come by, although there are some out there and they're not the greatest quality. I mean, I've heard some over the years that are just god awful, but my God, the content is so funny that I held on to them. So, the quality's not all the way there, but you can really hear the performances. Looks like our next one, we're going into the Frog Brigade era, and we're going to hear this intro of Holy Mackerel with the Frog Brigade.
Who's the band?
2002. All right, so we're talking about...
Could be Jay Lane.
Enor, right? Skerrick, Mike Dillon, and it could be Jay.
Let's play the old guessing game.
Yeah.
Who's on drums, Soya?
So it's not Jay. Actually, because of the time, it could be Dean Johnson.
Yeah.
Could be Tim Alexander, or it could even be Fish Fisher.
Right, because those fills are definitely not Jay Lane.
Okay.
When he does the little fill, they're very uncharacteristic of Jay Lane.
Dean Johnson played a ton of shows with Frog Brigade in 2002, yeah. So it very well
that's
might be
probably
him.
Steamy Dean. That's probably who it is. When were those Frog Brigade shows recorded that the CDs came out where they did Animals, Pink Floyd, at Great American?
Oh, 2000. That was like
2000.
Yeah.
So that was Jay and Todd. That was the first incarnation still rolling then. So okay. Yeah, this might be Steamy Dean came in after Jay bailed. Right?
That's a great name. Yeah, after Jay, yeah. They kind of had a rotating door of drummers. The next,
I never got to see Steamy Dean play live.
But you felt him because he's steamy.
2002, I would have been with Sheryl Crow.
Oh, okay.
Around the world, not doing Primus at that moment.
All right, so our penultimate live track here is from Frankie's Purple Onion bonus tracks collection. And it just says, Holy Mackerel, 6 minutes and 50 seconds. For a surprise.
Oh, yes. This one is going to blow your minds.
Okay, so if I'm super surprised, I will actually exclaim, Holy Mackerel! Let's see. There he goes. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I actually really like Jerry on the fretted. I might even like it more than the fretless. That's probably heresy to say, but like the Brown era when he was doing it on the fretted.
Yeah.
My very first Primus show was with Jay Lane Mach 2 or whatever we want to call it. Uh-huh. Les's Rainbow broke down when he started Jerry and he had to switch to the fretted. So the very first live Jerry I ever got was with a fretted six in the Jay Lane era, which was fantastic. I think it's a really cool version of that.
Nice of him to toss that out there on the fretted six.
Yeah, very considerate.
In the middle, especially in the middle of Holy Mackerel, like we just heard. Boy, I thought he was going to go the DMV route there for a second. That's what I thought I was hearing. And then he went to Jerry. I'll take it.
I was getting hints of Del Davis in there a little bit.
Oh, yeah. I think all of our imaginations were just running wild.
Yeah.
Oh, he's going to play something great. Oh,
what's he going to play next?
Let's
dude.
Do it. That fretted six, let's go. Our last live cut is from 2003. This also includes Brian Haas on Mellotron. Brian Haas, of course, of late has been touring and recording with Mike Dillon under the name Punkadelic. And Brian Haas also, I believe, a founding member and longtime member of Jacob Fred Jazz Odyssey and one hell of a key player. Frankie's caption to this is, and it's a question to you guys that hopefully you can answer afterwards, is this even Holy Mackerel? I think this is the Twin Peaks version of Holy Mackerel.
Yeah.
So after the second Holy Mackerel, we're all used to the crazy guitar solo, right?
Yeah.
But in this live rendition, after the second Holy Mackerel, they went into that.
Oh, so this is in place of where the guitar solo would be.
Yeah, this is the coda of the song.
Wow. Mm. This is... It's very different and very interesting. That's what I like about it. I haven't heard this one before. And I love Brian Haas, so I'm into it. It's yeah. This is if David Lynch was the musical director for Less.
That sounds about right.
It's amazing.
Black Lodge remix.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Frankie, thank you for those live cuts. We went from 1996 to 2003, and boy, did we run the gamut. Wow. I guess we ran the gauntlet of them, too.
Ran the gauntlet, yeah.
Dang. Missed opportunity, me. Well, Frankie, this is your favorite track on the record. Kind of a bummer that we have 13 more after this for you, but them's the breaks, buddy. Matt, where does this rank for you on the record?
I think there's some other stuff on this record that really shines for being, like you were talking about with Running the Gauntlet, like being more of a departure from the Primus sound that maybe gets a lot of extra points there. This is just like a really good stomping tune. Like I said, it's got a lot of layers. It feels really fully formed, and it's a little closer to that kind of Primus-y kind of home base. But I like a lot of this record. This ranks pretty up there in terms of my favorite non-Primus Claypool records because of the amount of variety on it. It goes a lot of really weird places. It's got a lot of unconventional layering where sometimes Les is layering like multiple basses on a single track.
Yeah.
He's just doing a lot of really interesting stuff on this record, but this is definitely towards the top of the heap for me with a couple other exceptions, maybe.
It's up there. It's great. It's a great song. I love it. It's great live, as we heard. Especially when we did the original band with Brain, was just fucking killer. You know?
Oh, man. Those two cuts were something else. Mm-hmm. Oh, boy. Mm-hmm. It's kind of hard for me to say this because I'm listening to these tracks as we go, and this is a record I haven't played in quite some time. So as far as activating my memories from 20-odd years ago, I think this is up there. But that is
subject to change. I can listen to this record again. I have not listened to it in a long time as well.
Yeah. So far, I mean, we're two tracks in. It's holding up for me. I can say that at least. I can also say this. Holy mackerel, you took the bait, and you've been tracked. Frankie, el próximo vez, bebemos con el Diablo.
Can't wait for that track. Also, a really interesting one.
Oh, very interesting. Boy, we got there. We hit the post just in time. Soya's yawning. He's got to get back to bed. It's a show day for him.
I gotta take a nap before I go do load-in.
There you go. Matt, it's about 3 in the morning where you are. I know you've got a shift to work. Frankie stayed up late. Bunch of night owls.
Oh, okay. Right on. There. What's next?
All right. Soya, thanks again for joining us. Matt, thank you for showing bass and guitar. You're a dual threat every
crazy.
Time you come on here, man. That's wonderful. Appreciate
thanks,
it.
Thanks, Matt.
Yeah, it was great. There you go.
Soya comes on here anytime he needs help sleeping. All right.
I'm committed, man. I'm committed.
I appreciate it. Fighting through the fatigue. All right, at Primus Tracks on the interweb. Matt, you can find him at HamOfTruth86. You can find Tim Soya, but good luck following him. And Frankie is at Frankie Beristein.
Don't forget to check out Primus Tracks on Facebook, too.
Oh, we'll get you to those 1,000 likes / follows / whatever it is. Later days.
Willie Mays.
Hello, Primates. It's that time of the month where we thank our patrons. If you would like to support the podcast as well, you can go to patreon.com/Primus Tracks. There are 4 tiers of support. Make sure you check out all the benefits of each to make the decision that suits you. Of course, you can pledge any amount, and Frankie and I will jump for joy. And if you have any questions, please reach out to us at Primus Tracks on Instagram and Twitter or through the email primustrackspod@gmail.com. For the month of April, we would like to thank John Gatwood, Tamby Meatfoot, that's a new one and a fun one, Brooks Deal, Ryan Reskin, Joseph Pebbler, Key Dog, Christian Rogers, Mike Coleman, Bradley Dunn, Jacob Nadeau, Nick in the Netherlands, thank you, Nick, Travis in Alaska, number one, Joseph Shack, Stephanie Wolfgang King, Alex DeLazio, Carl Reinch, Travis in Alaska, number two, Mike Chillian, Sarah Markham, Frank Pomus, Jesse Calton, Porter Kropf, Anthony Del Preet, The Cretan, or as Frankie says, The Cretan, John Shreve, David Fraser Crane, Johnny Perona, Mr. Funknificent, Michael Andrews, Johanny Coho, Steven Stang, Brian Kielb, Chris, Simon Altman all the way over there in Australia, Mike Tuckerman, Daryl Judd in the wilds of Canada, Skulligan Val, Chris Gentile, Keith Thompson, Kevin Lalowski, Amber Porter, and our very first patron, saving him for last, Carlos Arizmendi. Thank you all for your support, and I hope we get to read a lot more names next month. Later days again.
Really maze again.